Okay, so today we're going to be talking about reputation. And before I start this presentation, I want to stress that if you don't understand a word I'm going to say, or you're confused about a subject, please raise your hand right then and ask me a question. I won't be upset. If you're confused about something, probably someone else is confused about it too, so it'd be really good to hear about that. And also, I know that I speak quickly, so I'm sorry about that in advance. I want to try to make everyone understand what I'm saying. Okay, so let's start with the most basic one, which is, what is reputation? What do we think of as reputation? Does anyone have any ideas?
Yes.
Yeah, go ahead. Okay, so pointing out where you disagree, showing how the evidence that they've said is not true, or it's not right, or in some way that you disagree with, right? So that's part of what we do. Is there more to reputation besides just pointing out where you disagree? Okay.
Discrediting someone else's case.
Destroying the opposition's case, yeah, exactly. It's a chance for you to show that what the opposition is saying isn't true. In this lecture, we're going to try and go a little bit beyond that and show how, in many cases, people with reputations have a chance to attack the opposition to say that what they're saying isn't true. But what you should really try and look at reputation as is a chance to directly engage with the opposition's arguments. Because the biggest mistake I see people making in debates is that they treat it as an opportunity to go and stand and talk for 7 minutes. But debating isn't talking, it's engaging with an active process, which is something that I want to try and focus this lecture on. I want everyone to try and remember that what you really always want to be doing is trying to focus on the comparative between what your opponent is saying and what you are saying, and why, at the end of the day, the judge should be believing you over your opponent. So I'm going to refer to this metaphor throughout this lecture of imagine that debating is about building towers, building buildings. Both you and your opposition are trying to build the bigger tower. You're trying to build a better tower that will stand throughout the debate. Right? So you're doing it, your opponent's doing it at the same time. Through your speech, just adding arguments. Refutation, if you just say, if an opponent says something and tries to make an argument and says, this is true for my argument, you can prove that it is not true. So if it's factually incorrect, you can say, that's just not true, and give an example of how it's not true. And then you've taken that argument away from their tower. You've made their argument, their tower, be knocked down. But the best thing you can do is to try and take what's on their tower and then add it to your own, to steal it. So that when they make a point and say, this is true for our argument, you say, no, it's in fact true for our argument. It's true for what we're saying. This is the kind of comparative you always want to be focusing on within your debates. So what we're going to try to focus on here today is we're going to go through a couple of different types of refutation, rebuttal. I'll use those two words interchangeably, rebuttal and refutation. People think of them the same way. And we're going to talk about some ways that we work on grouping your refutation more effectively, and then some ways to add rebuttal and refutation in your own speech. Because everyone sees speeches where someone says, I'm going to make this argument, this argument, and this argument, but before I do that, I'm going to do some refutation. That's excellent. I'm not saying you shouldn't do that. But you shouldn't think of refutation as something that only happens at the beginning of your speech, and the rest of your speech is just you talking. No, refutation is something that should be coming up throughout the entirety of your speech. So you're constantly showing how your arguments compare to the other team's arguments, and your arguments are superior arguments, your arguments are more true arguments. Alright? So let's go through these different types of rebuttal, some of the more common ones, the ones that people say. The first type of rebuttal I want to talk about is called disputing the causal chain. So this type of rebuttal relies on disputing that the action specified will lead to the consequences claimed. So you're disputing that the action specified will lead to the consequences claimed. So if we wanted to look at this as if it were the format of the argument, so they're saying, because of A, B will happen. Because of D, C will happen. So an example of this is, let's say you were doing a debate about legalizing all drugs. Some team, you say we should legalize all drugs. The other team stands up and says, if we legalize all drugs, there'll be large numbers of street drug dealers, people who are selling drugs all over the place. And because of this, we're going to have lots and lots of violence, because the kind of people who sell street drugs are likely to be criminals, and there'll be gang violence that form around these issues. Right? So this is a causal chain that the opponent has set up. They said, this causes this, which causes this, and this is bad. So because this is bad, we don't want to do this. Right? So what you should try and do with those arguments is attack those arguments at their weakest point. The weakest, can anyone guess what the weakest point of this argument is? So this argument is about drug dealers and saying that this is legalizing all drugs. This is street dealers, people who are really selling the drugs. And this is gangs. Right? Where, if you were going to attack this argument, where do you think the easiest place for you to attack this argument?
The first step,
exactly. So this is the weakest point between these two arguments. Because it makes pretty good sense that if there were lots and lots of street drug dealers, some of them would probably organize into bigger gangs, and there'd be lots of violence that'd be really bad for society. So it's really hard to say, well, there will be street drug dealers, but we'll all be friendly and nice to each other, and it'll be great. If you want to tackle this weakest point, can someone tell me a way that you could show that legalizing all drugs wouldn't necessarily lead to street dealers in this argument? How would you refute that point? Aaron, any ideas? So maybe you could say that we're going to legalize drugs by selling them in stores. So just because we're legalizing drugs doesn't mean that someone, heroin is okay. Go find heroin on your own. I mean, maybe we're saying only legalize. So like similar to alcohol. Alcohol is legal in many societies, but that doesn't mean that you can just sell, you can make any alcohol you want and sell it to whoever you want. There has to be some level of regulation. So in many cases, these types of causal links rely on weak points, and this is where you want to attack that. Okay? And by doing this, none of this is long, there's not any value. So lots of people make the mistake when they're making reputation, spending a lot of time just attacking every step of the chain. They say, well, we'll make it better here, make it better here. And also, of course not, street dealers aren't related to that. And there are other things you can do here. Don't worry about that. Just attack it at its weakest point and say, once this weakest point is here, none of these things matter anymore, and so I'm going to move on. The judge's mind, the judge says, you've destroyed their argument already. You didn't need to explain how you entirely destroyed their argument. You've just gotten it out of the way and you're done with it. Because with your rebuttal and with your reputation, you want to make sure that you're managing your time as effectively as you can. And this is another point that I'd like to make here, which is people sometimes make the mistake in refutation of thinking that every single thing the opposition said needs to be responded to in your own speech. It doesn't, especially in higher level debate. If something is just evidently not true, you can assume that your judge is intelligent enough, they don't need to have that point at. So if someone said, World War II was a fight between America and Canada, everyone knows that that's not true. You'd be wasting your time and reputation by saying, oh, look how silly the other team is. They tried to make this claim and it's not true. You could just move on, focus on the points that are directly clashing with next thing I want to talk about is a type of rebuttal that's disputing the value framework. This is another type of rebuttal that comes out very frequently, where people propose a certain type of value, a certain type of value, and say that that is the thing that this debate ought to be measured on. So they say they might not have justified that something is valuable. Frequently, people just assume that things are. So they say something like, this is going to make us the most money, or this is going to save the most number of trees, or this is going to have this value come about, right? But they don't necessarily do the work to justify this claim. So again, if we see it as a similar sort of eraser. A similar sort of almost equation, you can see that if this is the value they're justifying, if they're saying, you really care about A, because A is making money, let's say. Right? So they're going to make arguments that all rely on A. They're going to say, how can we get to A? Right? So they're going to make all these arguments that say, we'll do our policy. Our policy is going to propose something, and doing that something is going to make money. If you attack this value, if you undermine the value and say that, arguments here. If you attack this value, if you can show and rebuttal why making money might not always be the most important thing, maybe human rights are more important, maybe environmental protection is more important, maybe there are other ways to make that money, like that this value isn't necessarily the most important thing, and these arguments don't matter as much because they all rely on this being the important value. So attacking and denying the value framework a good idea. Now, you should be careful here, because some values seem to be overwhelmingly true and are really hard to attack. So if their value is, we want to make it so the fewest number of children die, you're going to have a very hard time showing that keeping children from dying is not an important value, because everyone thinks that that is an important value. So you want to be careful with those things. But frequently, if they're trying to justify the value of something that's more nebulous, that's more in contest, something like the value of money in society, or retribution in criminal justice, which is something that frequently comes up, where someone says, you know, it seems like it must be really important that we always punish people in our society. So if someone's done something wrong, they really need to be punished. Well, why? Why is that necessarily the most important thing? Attack that value instead of attacking the things that come off of that value. And you'll find yourself destroying the argument at its root and probably destroying a lot of other aspects of their case that rely on this value being the most important thing. So, the next thing I want to talk about is disputing the importance of arguments. So, rebutting by disputing the importance of things. So, this form of rebuttal works by disputing the importance. This can work broadly in two ways. And in many cases, you should use both of these ways together. So, the first one is damage limitation, and the second one is describing that there are other things that are more important. So, starting with damage limitation. Sometimes an argument just seems to be correct in some ways. In such a case, it might make sense that you should at least accept that to some degree it is important. So, if it's argued that a policy will reduce economic growth, so because we're doing X, there's going to be far less economic growth and development, which is going to lead to, again, that's the value they're establishing. They're establishing that, they're establishing importance. They're saying this economic growth is going to occur, and because of this, all these other bad things are happening. If you think that's true, it may make sense to concede that, to say, yes, we all agree that there's some extent of. We don't want to reduce economic growth. So in the last debate, the debate we did earlier this morning, the debate about offering affirmative action for women in the workplace, essentially, if one of the teams is saying, you know, we're proposing equality for women, and we want to achieve equality for women, it would be very, very hard for you to say, on opposition, you know, we don't stand for equality for women. You can concede to some degree, yes, we do need to have some policies that are important for this. But you can do damage limitation to say why it's only going to be effective to some degree. So if in the last debate, the teams on government were saying, we need to have affirmative action for women in the workplace, because that's the way that we need to have positive policies for women in the workplace, because that's the way we're going to end sexism in the workplace, you could say, yes, we agree with you that we need to have positive action for women in the workplace, but there are other things we can do. There are ways we can do this, and there are other harms you're not identifying. So you're limiting the damage of their points. You're making it seem like it's less important by stressing other things. And this also makes you seem a lot more credible, because if in many cases the thing that they're saying seems to be obviously true, it's very hard to convince a judge who intuitively thinks that it's true that it isn't. So you'll have a much harder time showing a judge why they ought not care about gender equality, why they ought not care about saving the most number of lives. A much easier time showing them that these things are perhaps less important, or that there are other factors that are going on here. And if you just accept those things and then move on with your own arguments, you won't find yourself getting lost within those arguments and making yourself seem less credible. Again, though, it's important to note that this is not enough to be the other teams. Just saying, that's not that important, I'm moving on, is not going to be enough to you, because it's then very easy for the team to say that something is perhaps not mutually exclusive, that your alternative that you're providing is something that we can do as well. You probably need to extend more benefits that your policy has lots of benefits, while also suggesting that your policy is avoiding harms, your advocacy. And you often want to explicitly do this. So say, while you're defending that, say, they claim this was important. We agree that it is important, but it's less important than they're saying it is, and this other thing is far more important. We'll talk about this in a little bit, how doing this within your own arguments is something that can be very effective to say, this is what they're saying, or what we're saying is more important. Which leads to my next point. So responding by saying other things are more important is frequently a way that you can move the ground of the debate towards what you're saying. Because frequently in debates, you get these competing claims. One side says, let's say the notion was, this House would prioritize economic development over environmental protection. That's a clear contrast between these two things. One side is going to say, you know, look at all of these things that are important about economic development. It leads to employment, it leads to better rates of education in society, it leads to more global competitiveness, and go on and on and on with these things. But you can say, yes, all of that is true, but other things are more important. It is true that having more employment is good for society, but you're forgetting that it doesn't matter if you have employment if there's no clean water. It doesn't matter if you have employment if you have no viable natural resources. Things like that are more important. Again, just saying that is unlikely to be enough to win you that argument, or to at the very least get rid of their own argument. You need to say, these things are more important, and while we agree that that's the case, we think that what you're saying is useful, our stuff is more useful. You should want to value our own stuff. And you're comparing these arguments. You should do it as explicitly as possible. You should tell the judge, you should do the work for the judge. So you should say, this is what they are saying. We're comparing it directly with what we are saying. And this is why our stuff is better. It's oftentimes much more effective to admit that what the opponent is saying is valuable. I mean, if you're in a debate, especially a high-level debate, frequently the people who are across the bench from you are very intelligent. They might even be more intelligent than you are. They might have higher levels of education than you are. So what they're saying isn't stupid. It's not wrong. This is a mistake that people often make in debates. They assume that just because they were put on the opposite side from the person, that their job is to say that the other person was stupid. No, you can just say, what you're trying to do is misguided. We agree that your intentions are good, but it's misguided. You're missing the more important things. And judges frequently like to see this. They see that you're engaging with the debate as in a more mature way. You're not just dismissing people and telling them they're stupid. The next thing I want to talk about is disputing the comparative analysis. So denying the comparative, we can say that a different comparative is relative. So frequently in a debate, a team will try and set up something and say, it's a choice between this and a choice between this. So again, returning to the debate, the idea that I mentioned of economic development versus environmental protection. A team arguing for economic development might say, this is a choice between having lots of people employed and having a functional economy, or this is a choice between our society being languishing and being at the bottom of the world economy, right? Denying that comparative is also a very effective way to do refutation. So you can say, that's a false choice. You're trying to tell the judge, it's a choice between, they're trying to tell the judge it's a choice between A or B. Pointing out that there's another comparison that's more important. Maybe it's a choice between, having fewer people be employed, but having a more long-term development available within your country. That's the real choice the judge should be weighing. This gains you a lot of benefits because, again, you're not denying that their arguments are relevant. You're just saying they're missing the point of this debate, and our point is more relevant. Our comparative is more relevant. So these are sort of common ways to think about rebuttal, ways to think about rebuttal, because in many cases, you want to try and stress that the opponent is saying is frequently relevant, but that there are small flaws in their thinking. So try and think what the other opponents, what your opponent's arguments are saying as. Think of them, take them at their best, and then move on. There's one other specific thing I wanted to talk about before I talk about it's called implicit refutation, or doing refutation within your own arguments. And that's an idea of model critiques. So frequently, especially this only happens if you're on opposition, a team will say the keywords were that I just talked about, or what I'm talking about now? I just talked about? Okay, so what I talked about was the first one, which was disputing, I have terrible chalk for him right now, sorry. The causal chain. So this was the idea where someone says A leads to B, leads to C, C is bad. So remember again, you attack here. That's disputing the causal chain. The next one was disputing the value framework. It looks similar to this in many ways, but this is a value. So let's say this is retribution. They say, because this is important, because retribution is important, we should we should have the death penalty, we should torture people, we should lock people up for as long as we can, for instance. And you say, no, this is wrong. I don't agree with this value. Right? So that's disputing the value framework. Is there a way to pull that up? Does everyone have this down? Can I raise this first thing? Sorry. Next one I talk about is disputing importance. Right? So you can say that what they said is important, but you limit the importance of what they said. What they said is not what's truly relevant for the debate. What's truly relevant for the debate is some other factor. You do that through either damage limitation.
Speak in this debate, and no one wants to spend an hour talking about this.
right? That's, no, that's not why we do debate. Right? So you suggest an alternative. You say, we're going to, you know, that's wrong. That's not what a debate means. Instead, we're going to talk about what would have happened if you had said something that made sense. So by invade, we're going to guess someone is going to land troops in Syria and start fighting the Assad regime. So you suggest an alternative, and you do get a team to work for them. Don't worry, that team's going to be penalized, they're probably going to get the 4, but then you're going to be able to make all the arguments that are really important for your team. Your team is still going to be able to do a good job and be in that debate. So you suggest the alternative, and this is the most important one, move on. People so frequently get hung up on this. Like, how could you screw that up? What's wrong with you? Why did you do that? Right? You only have 7 minutes. You don't want to spend a minute of your speech just complaining. Point it out, suggest an alternative, and then go right back to what you would have said if they had something said something that made sense. Right? Because probably the other teams of government weren't going to do something crazy like suggesting that they need to send pictures of us. Right? So just move on, get back to your arguments, and then you'll be able to go. So that's what you do when it's something that's very obvious, right? So those don't happen very frequently, but they're definitely something to look out for. This is something that often happens if you're an advanced team and you're in a room with some teams that are perhaps not so advanced. You don't want to, you know, come off as a jerk just because you've been debated more than they do. You don't want to use that as an opportunity to beat down them. Because a judge might say, well, I was going to give them the 4, but now you were a huge jerk to them, to someone who's just started debating, and that's going to do bad things to your speaker points, or I think that you're less credible. So it's not something you want to do. So does everyone have this? Yes? Okay. That's the obvious. So the ones that are a little trickier are the ones that are misinterpretations or lack of efficacy. So what would we title these? Problematic, let's say. So let's say that the motion was this house would pay drug addicts to be sterilized. Okay? And the model they propose is government pays for sterilization procedures. What's wrong with this model? Some time? So if the motion is, I'm sorry, I got my hand ready. The motion is, this house would pay drug addicts to be sterilized. An opening government gets up and says, what we're going to do is we're going to pay, so it's totally free, and if you're a drug addict, you can go get sterilized. What's wrong with that? Anyone? All right, you're laughing. What's the problem with that model?
About payment. You get sterilized, then you get the money.
It's not. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. It doesn't matter if it's free. If someone walked up to me and said, hey, I'll pay for it, you're going to get sterilized, that probably wouldn't be very convincing to me, right? So what you do want to do is point out this flaw. Because if you don't point it out, this is a pretty obvious example. But in some cases where there's a flaw in the logic of the model, this model is never going to lead to any arguments they make about why we want to have drug addicts sterilized, we don't want them in our society. It's never going to be relevant. So you need to figure out a way to deal with this, but you don't want to spend you don't want to waste a whole bunch of your speech pointing this out. So it's a very similar strategy to what you would do for if it was a very obvious flaw or something that's just a clear misinterpretation. One, point out the logic. What about the logical flaw? Two, you would show how arguments don't flow from that. And then three, do it again. Move on. I cannot stress this enough. People, even the very best debaters, make mistakes where they think, I've got them now. I don't have to argue, I don't have to make real arguments. Because all I have to do is show that this model wouldn't work for this case, because their arguments don't work. Do not do that. What you should do is assume that the other team had done the best version of their case, and that you need to be a very good case with the rest of your arguments. Right? Don't think that you're just going to be able to get away with only doing refutation, with only showing how this doesn't make any sense, it doesn't do anything, without providing counter-arguments about why this is a bad idea. So, the biggest thing I can say about model critiques is that models are problems and things that occur, but they shouldn't derail you from focusing on the emotion. Okay? So I just want to talk about that as sort of a specific form of refutation, because those things frequently occur. And that's sort of very special. You should be doing that even when you do refutation in your speech. It's a very specialized part of refutation that occurs. I'm sorry, can I erase all this? It's just good.
So what I want to talk about now is doing implicit refutation. So, implicit refutation
some version of the argument that is, well, A woman who gets a job because of affirmative action isn't going to be perceived as equal to her male employees. Everyone's going to say, you only got this job because of affirmative action. That's the argument that comes up in every affirmative action debate, whether it's based on race or gender or socioeconomic class or anything. Right? So instead of waiting for them to say that argument, you say it first. You say, they're going to tell you that women are not going to be perceived as equal, that women are going to be perceived as weak here. But we tell you that women have, that once women do succeed, that perception is going to go away because there's nothing fundamentally preventing a woman from succeeding in the workplace the same as her male counterparts, right? Then when the other team gets up and just says, well, women are going to be perceived as equal, they have to do a whole lot more work to show why that's still a real argument, why it's still something the judge should care about. And if they don't do that, the judge is like, hey, you already beat that argument. You don't even have to rebut it again. You can just say, as my partner already told you, that's not true. And the judge is like, wow, you are very good at debating. You knew that argument was going to come out. So this is something that you want to do in prep time, is think about how not only what are your own arguments, not only what are the strongest arguments, but ask your partner, have your partner ask you, what do we think the best things that are going to be coming out of the opposition side, or the government side of your opposition? What do we think the best things that the other side are going to say so you can be ready for them? Because the men in these issues, you know, they're pretty obvious responses. If someone comes up with a brilliant answer and you just really weren't ready for it, then you can handle it within the debate and you can get ready for it by reverting back to your strategies, or disputing the value framework, or disputing the causal chain. But if it's something that you know is going to come up, you don't have to wait to do those things. You can just do them first within your own speech. So in terms of implicit refutation, leave space. These might seem like odd things to tell advanced debaters, and I'm telling you, this is how you should take notes, but I'm telling you, they'll be extremely helpful. When you find yourself leaving space and say, an argument is not complete until it interacts with the other side of the debate. Arguments don't stand on their own, they interact with all of the components of the debate. So write with a different color and leave yourself space, because that will force you to engage. It will force you to say, no, this is my argument. I'm telling you that women in the workplace need an opportunity because once they're given opportunities, they're going to succeed. Opposition believes that but this is why it's not true. You're constantly reminding your judge of that back and forth between these two issues. That, you know, there is this other world. You admit that this other world exists, but you'd so much rather live in this one. And the judge should too. And that's far more convincing than just pretending that the other team's world doesn't exist, or the other team's world isn't there. That you're going to have far more success. So we're starting to run out of time here. Does anyone have any questions about refutation or things they found within their own refutation that they wish were strong? Any questions at all? Yeah. Sure. That's a good point. So you definitely don't want to be doing the other team's work for them. You don't want to say, maybe the one-child policy was bad for human rights. Man, maybe it was bad for human rights. What if it was bad for this reason, and this reason, and this reason, and this reason, and this reason? Don't do that. Let the other team do that. But acknowledging that it is an issue, and preempting it, and saying, the other team is going to tell you several reasons why it's bad for human rights. But what we say on our side is that we accept that. So you do what I talked about when I said damage limitation. So you concede that exists. No one's pretending that there weren't violations of human rights. You know, telling a woman that she has to get an abortion might be a violation of her human rights. But another value is more important, the value of having a society that's sustainable, that is overpopulated, that is, collective, thinking about what's best for the collective nation instead of best for the individual. So you're right that you shouldn't spend 3 minutes on doing those things, but you can quickly, when you're talking about those things, stress the importance of them. So if you on opposition were arguing that it's really important, people should care about what's best for the entire nation, that's when you could just say, and this comes at the sacrifice of some people's human rights, but any large-scale problem has sacrifices. That's the kind of implicit refutation you can do while still doing describing the damage rotation. Admitting that the problem is real. Say, this world doesn't, that you're describing does exist, but it's just not as important. It's just not as influential as it's on. Anyone else have any other thoughts? Questions?
How to make your comparison more convincing? Because you may say the economic growth is not that important than clean water. And
sure. So the way you can focus, it's an excellent question.
Yeah.
So the way you can focus on doing these things is you really don't want to be doing what's called a straw. You don't want to say, if the other side is saying economic growth is important, they're not saying economic growth is more important than absolutely anything everywhere. So we're not going to kill babies in the name of economic growth. That's not what they're saying. And you have to resist the temptation to try and dumb down their argument. Engage their argument. What you can say is you can show the nuances within your own arguments, the complexities within your own arguments, by saying, they're telling you these economic growths occurs, but with clean water, you still have the opportunity, or preserving resources. If you just use all of those resources up in the name of economic growth, then, economic growth is going to be limited. Maybe you want less economic growth at first, but a longer period of economic growth, which in the long term means more jobs and more stability for the country. So, trying to look at that issue of perhaps it'll work over a longer period of time, or perhaps what you're suggesting is going to be maybe sometimes the opposite of true. Maybe what you're saying is, so if you're dealing with crime, maybe we really need to crack down on crime right now. That's going to cause some problems right now, but the benefits will be huge. Or something like ending unemployment, because cycles of unemployment can be really, really bad for the nation. So we need to crack down on unemployment right now, and then that's what's going to be really good for the nation in the long term. So trying to look at the time frame of the issues, and also looking at the number of the people affected by the issues, or the type of effects that's going to be. Because frequently you can describe and characterize your situation as what's more important and what's more relevant for the judge to determine what is left. Any other questions?
We've got another 5 minutes. So
I guess the remaining couple minutes I have, The other point about refutation that I think is important about this is that sometimes it may be the case that you don't want to use your entire argument in refutation. So frequently people have this fact that just because the opponent said something, my only time to do that is in the refutation here, the beginning of my speech, or for some nationalities at the end of my speech. For instance, Canadian teams frequently do refutation at the end of their speeches. Right? But if you know that you're going to be answering that question, you know that you have an entire argument about that issue, it's going to be coming up later, you can just not worry about it. Don't worry about it. And the judge might think in their head, oh my god, we're missing this really big point. That doesn't matter. What you should care about is what the judge is going to think about your entire speech at the end of your speech. So if you know that you're going to rebuttal, you know that you're going to have responses to the point, it's much better to wait until it's coming out to be your own arguments. You're not responding to a point. You're making your own arguments that compare with their arguments. That's a much better way to go about doing refutation. It's a much more convincing way to go about doing refutation. Because even if you aren't able to say, this was their point, but the response is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it's wrong for these 5 reasons. Like, that seems like the kind of thing that would be really fun. You could really thoroughly defeat their argument, right? But you just spent 5 minutes talking about them. Don't spend all that time talking. You still want to be talking about yourself. Let me stress that your material their material does exist, but your material is more relevant than the material. Save these points about why these things are not true as much as you can until your own argumentation. So when I see people and they say, I'm going to have 6 points of refutation, when they talk about refutation for 4 minutes, I frequently think you're making a mistake. Right? Refutation should be short. It should be the things that you're not going to be able to deal with later, because they're just a couple extra issues that you want to get out of the way. So I'm not going to be able to address this point that the opponent's making. So I'll get it out of the way now, so we can forget it, so we can, I've dealt with that issue, and now I can get my own material. So it's a frequent mistake that people make when they want to spend all of this time trying to fight the opponent's arguments in the beginning. No, fight the opponent's arguments through your own arguments, through your own constructive material. You'll find yourself with much more convincing arguments and much more convincing points. So that's the lecture on refutation. If anyone has any questions, please come and talk to me. I'll be happy to talk to you about refutation or any other issues related to the debate. All right, thank you very much.